In turning your Bibles to the New Testament book of Galatians, we begin a series tonight on the New Testament book of Galatians written by the Apostle Paul, and this is a brand new study, so as you find it in your Bibles, let me, maybe this will be a helpful tip for you. Someone once told me that you can remember these few books in the New Testament, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians, by remembering General Electric Power Company. Have you ever heard that before? GEPC. So if you're ever confused about what order they come in, General Electric Power Company, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. And parents, let me encourage you. You know, Seeds Family Worship was here just a few weeks ago. They have some spectacular CDs that help you learn the books of the Bible from Genesis all the way to Revelation. And so I want to encourage you to teach your kids. And maybe you don't know all the books of the Bible in order and how all the minor prophets fit together and how they all go. But hopefully tonight you can find the book of Galatians in your Bible. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians will be right in there. And we begin a series tonight. And the series I've entitled this series in the book of Galatians, Justified. Justified. The Bible tells us that in Christ, as we appear before a holy God, we are justified. And the word justified simply means just as if I'd never sinned. God declares us righteous, even though we are guilty, even though we are wicked, even though we are sinful, even though we are stained. When we are justified, God, the righteous judge, chooses to look upon the sacrifice of Jesus Christ and His blood shed for us. God chooses to look upon His righteousness and imputes the righteousness of Christ to our sinful account so that we can stand before a holy God just and righteous. That's what it means to be justified. And that's a theme throughout the book of Galatians. The theme is about freedom in Christ, about grace and faith, about justification by grace through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So to be justified means to be made right with God. By God's grace, we're justified. And Galatians makes it clear, not because of our works and not because of our righteousness, but because of grace. Let's take a moment and read Galatians chapter 1 and verses 1 to 5 as we begin this study tonight. I want to think with you about this subject, the spiritual rescue. The spiritual rescue from Galatians chapter 1. Begin reading with me in verse 1. Paul, an apostle, not from men nor through man, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead. And all the brothers who were with me, to the churches of Galatia, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, a very familiar greeting from the Apostle Paul, who gave himself for our sins to deliver us from this present evil age, according to the will of God our Father, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Remember tonight, the power is in the Word of God. In the course of the 30 years or so of time that elapsed between Paul's Damascus Road experience, it was about 30 years from when Paul trusted Jesus there and was captured by grace on the road to Damascus, and Paul was imprisoned in Rome facing death. So in between that time, about 30 years, Paul would travel. He had three prominent and well-known missionary journeys. And on those missionary journeys, he would travel, he would share the gospel, he'd lead people to Christ, and he'd invite them to follow the Lord, and then he would write letters back to those churches. And Galatia, the city or the community or the region of Galatia, was one of those cities. These journeys were, of course, his missionary journeys were followed by letters that he wrote. And Galatians is believed to be, by most scholars, one of the earliest of these types of letters. It's assumed that Galatians was written sometime around A.D. 48 or A.D. 49. And the Bible tells us it's addressed to the churches of Galatia. Now, that's not just one church. You see the plural word churches. So it's not just one church and it's not just one city. It's an area. And we'll see Paul's missionary journey. We'll see in just a little while where he was and what he was doing and all the churches that are involved. So he's not just writing to one church. He's writing to many churches. And the theme of this message tonight is the spiritual rescue. The spiritual rescue. In 1987, an 18-month-old little girl became very famous very quickly. Does anyone remember the name Jessica McClure? Does anybody remember that name? Little baby Jessica, as she's known. She's married now. She has kids of her own. She's already inherited a trust fund of some $800,000 because I'm sure her story became very popular. But little baby Jessica was out playing in the backyard. She was being watched there by some family friends, I believe. In 1987, all of America stopped to watch this real-life drama unfold in Midland, Texas. This 18-month-old little baby girl fell down a 22-inch well shaft. If you don't remember the details of the story, I'll give you a summary of what happened. After 55 grueling hours of being stuck somewhere in that well shaft, all the nation tuned in. At the bottom of a 22-foot well, 18-month-old baby Jessica, what did she do? Well, she began with all her might and strength to grab hold of the sides of the well, and she began to climb out the best of her ability. And finally, after 55 hours, she peered her head out all by herself and was rescued. You remember that story? And you're like, whoa, that's not what happened, is it? No, that's not the way it went. That's not the way it went at all. You know how it went? They spent all sorts of time. I mean, think about it. If you're rescuing a little baby out of a small little well shaft, you can't go in from the top because all the stuff's going to fall on top of her. You've got to be incredibly careful going in from the side because you don't know exactly where she is or how deep she is in the well. They had to drill through all sorts of stuff to get down to her so that they could get her and rescue her and bring her out. Now, let me compare this to our spiritual rescue. You and I were in the exact same situation, and there was no amount of clawing or climbing or working or self-effort that could get us to the top of where we needed to be. We were stuck. We were in chains. We were in bondage. But the Bible says in Romans 5:6, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Jesus Christ appeared in glory and might and power to rescue us when we could not rescue ourselves. Jesus came and rescued us from the pit of sin and despair, pulled us up by his strength and power and glory. That is the spiritual rescue. The good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ is that by faith in Jesus, we can be rescued. We can be redeemed. And the message of this salvation is the most important message in all the world. There's no more important message than the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. This message had changed Paul's life. Paul was a different man. He was a brand new man, completely and totally transformed. And through Paul, this message transformed many, many others. They trusted in Jesus as a result of the testimony of Paul. But the Bible tells us after Paul established the churches in Galatia and went about his journey, false teachers crept in. In fact, if you'll notice, all throughout Scripture, the Bible makes it clear that anytime the truth is sown, the enemy will come in and sow lies. And most of the time, what he will do is he will couch those lies with just enough truth to make them believable. That's exactly what happened in the churches of Galatia. The Judaizers, that's a name you're going to need to remember. It's a group of people you're going to need to know. The Judaizers would come into churches just like the churches in Galatia, and they would say, well, that message the Apostle Paul preached, he's really, really close, but he's just not quite right. I mean, he's getting there. He's doing pretty good, but you got a little bit more to go. That message the Apostle Paul preached about grace and about freedom and about justification, that's good. But what you don't understand is you've got to become like a Jew before you can become a Christian. You've got to be circumcised and you've got to follow the law and you have to follow all these rites and rituals. You've got to become like a Jew before you become like a Christian. And then it got worse. They began to insult the Apostle Paul. Some historians that were maybe 100 years removed from the life of Paul would describe Paul as a very short man with an arched back, a crooked nose, a unibrow, and balding and not very attractive. And the Judaizers would say that Paul, hey, he's a guy who's got really, really big words. But when you see him in person, his persona doesn't really back up those words. In other words, yeah, he's a real tough guy when he's not around, but when you see the guy, he's not much. And that just proves that God loves to use people the world thinks are useless. God can do great and mighty and incredible things through all sorts of people when we surrender everything we are to him. So what's happening in the churches in Galatia? There's confusion. Many of them have trusted in Jesus Christ, but now they're confused because these religious leaders are coming to them saying, grace is not enough. You have to add works. And Paul writes this letter to remind them of the message that he taught. It is that salvation is by grace through faith alone, plus absolutely nothing. God has done all the work. We simply must respond and receive his salvation. And that's the message of Galatians. So these false teachers are spreading a false gospel. And Paul's not going to stand by and let it happen. So let's dive into Galatians chapter 1, the first five verses, and see what this spiritual rescue looks like. Number one, the spiritual rescue was initiated by God's plan. It was initiated by God's plan. Maybe you notice something interesting about the book of Galatians. In almost every letter of Paul, Paul writes and gives a greeting, and this is a typical greeting. In those days, you would write your name first because the person wanted to know where it was coming from. These days, we write the person's name to whom we're writing, we put that first. In those days, it was backwards. You'd put your name if you were writing the letter. So you have a typical greeting, and in most of Paul's letters, there's a commendation. Even in the letter to the Corinthians, those who were living in vile and wicked ways, Paul gives them a commendation. But if you notice in the book of Galatians, there is no word of encouragement or commendation. Paul runs right into, in verse 6, I'm astonished that you're deserting the one who called you. I'm astonished that you are deserting grace. And what we notice is the anxiety and anger of Paul expresses itself in this way. He has no time. He has no time for idle chatter or even compliments. He's got to get right down to the message. It's almost as if a parent or a friend, what they would experience if a child or companion was going seriously astray. What would you do? You'd want to correct it. Now, how many of you have children? Let me see your hands. Raise them up. How many of you have more than one child? We've got more than one. And if you can imagine, what would happen at my house? What would happen at my house if Caroline, who's almost two, was playing over near the electrical outlet, and she had a paper clip in her hand. And I walked by, and there was one of her older brothers or older sisters, and they were teaching her how to push the paper clip into the electrical outlet. Now, some of you probably have a little bit more patience than I do when it comes to something like that. So you'd probably, you know, pull up a chair, and you'd just sit right down next to them and say, now, sweetheart, that's not a good idea. Is that what you do? Let me have the paperclip, please. Come on. Please. The way Caroline is right now. Give me the paperclip! You know, she's in a little bit more of a difficult stage at this moment. What would you do? Is that how you would handle the situation? I want you to know, you two are such precious little darling angel babies. We're so grateful that God gave you to us, and we love you so much, and you're just so wonderful and smart, and you just start complimenting them in hopes that they give you the paperclip. Is that what you would do? No. No parent in their right mind would do that. What would you do? You would run over there, risking life and limb for yourself, jumping over the coffee table, doing backflips over the couch, trying your best to get the paperclip out of your child's hand because you know there's a great danger. There are times when you just don't have a moment to be polite. And Paul is saying, I don't have time to fool around. This is dangerous. This is significant. This is serious. And this needs to be corrected and corrected immediately. He's trying to fix a mess that would destroy so many lives. So he's writing to a group of Christians. The church is in Galatia. It's in the southern region of Galatia, modern-day Turkey. He's writing a letter to the churches, as you see in the book of Acts, the Pisidian, Antioch, Lystra, Derbe, and Iconium. All these churches played a part in his first missionary journey. He'd received word that the Judaizers had taken root in the church. And what is he doing? These people are teaching the gospel is grace plus works equals righteousness. That's not the way it works. You know, we have people who teach that same thing today. People teach that same thing. Now that you're saved, follow this list of rules. And now that you're saved, follow this list of do's and don'ts. And now that you're saved, this is how you earn favor in God's sight. Listen to me carefully, church. I want you to understand, I believe in righteousness. I believe in holy living. I believe in sanctification. I believe in separation. But it is driven out of a heart that loves and honors the Lord Jesus Christ and fullness with the Spirit of God, seeking to bring Him glory. I believe in all of that, but it is an intrinsic motivation because of the Spirit of God that dwells in us, not some extrinsic list of rules and rituals that are supposed to earn us some type of favor in God's sight. It is grace plus nothing. God offers salvation. It's not your works. It's not your effort. We are coming to Him by grace through faith. Look at what he says in verses 1 and 2. Paul, an apostle, not from men nor through man, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father, who he raised from the dead, and all the brothers that are with me. Notice this now. This is an important part of the message. The first verse, Paul, an apostle. Do you see what he says? Circle that word in your Bible. This is important. Because what the Judaizers were trying to do, what the legalists were trying to do, is they were trying to say, Paul has no authority, therefore his message doesn't matter. You see, the best way to defeat the message was to attack the messenger. And so what they would say is, it doesn't matter what Paul taught. It doesn't matter what Paul said, because he's not really an apostle. It doesn't matter what Paul thought. Where are his credentials? He wasn't one of the original 12. In fact, he wasn't. So Paul had a harder case of proving to others that he was called as an apostle. Now notice in Galatians 1, 2, near the end of that verse, all the brothers who are with me, Paul makes a distinction. Paul calls himself an apostle. This is a word, let me be very clear, especially in the New Testament and especially today, this is a word that is reserved for a select few. An apostle was one who was directly called by Jesus Christ. Directly, visibly, verbally called by Jesus Christ. The 12 apostles, and then also the apostle Paul on the road to Damascus. It is a very, very short list of people. Now, all of us can be included in the brothers and sisters and saints and Christ followers, but the word apostle, the title apostle, is significant. Those who were directly called by Jesus Christ in the New Testament. Now, you may see some people on TV, apostle this and apostle that. It's just not true. It's just not right. Now, in the sense that we're called out to take the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ like the apostles were, I get that and I understand that. But today, the Bible tells us we're brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ. But we don't have apostles today like we did in the New Testament. The apostles' words, their writings, were the writings of Scripture. God used them to write the Bible. God inspired them. So we can call ourselves followers of Christ, brothers and sisters, but I'm not Apostle Jim, and I'm thankful for that. I like to be Pastor Jim, or Dad, or husband. This word can't be used to describe everybody, but what did they do? They began to attack the messenger and the message. So Paul had to establish his apostolic authority. And what does he say? Paul, an apostle, look at this clearly now, not from men, not through man, but through Jesus Christ. Paul is saying, I am no self-appointed teacher. I was trained by the Lord Jesus Christ. I didn't call myself, God called me. He was called directly by Jesus on the road to Damascus. He had the authority to preach. Paul's saying, I have the authority to preach. I'm an apostle. Now, sometimes when our kids are outside playing, one of them may be inside, and we'll say, maybe Jake's inside. Jake, go tell your brothers and sisters it's time to come inside and wash up for dinner. And sometimes this is what happens. If Jake goes outside and tells Judd and Anna Kate and Sadie and Caroline to come inside, it's time to wash up. Sometimes what happens is they might ignore their brother. Especially if he just says, hey, go wash your hands. So sometimes I need to be specific. And what I say is, Jake, now you got to get his attention, right? Look me in the eye, son. Jake, you know, go tell your brothers and sisters that Dad said to come and wash up. The hope is that one little phrase, that one little difference, that one little change motivates them to do what they're told to do. It's not just Jake, their brother, coming to say it's time to wash up. It's their father who's given a command, and they rush to obedience without argument, without hesitation, without reservation, right? That's the way it's supposed to be. Well, Paul is making it clear. Paul's saying, look, this isn't my thing. This is God's thing. And church, listen to me clearly. This is the truth of the gospel. These aren't Paul's words. These aren't my words. These are the very words of God. The Bible tells us the spiritual rescue was initiated by God's plan. Number two, the spiritual rescue was implemented by God's action. Look what the Bible says here in verses 3 and 4. So these legalists want the Galatians to believe they have to follow a set of rules or a list of regulations to be right with God, as if they could fix some things on the outside and that would make it right on the inside. They want them to believe that as long as they abide by these standards or Jewish rules and regulations, that somehow they're righteous. We desperately need a spiritual rescue, just like baby Jessica. She was helpless to save herself. We couldn't climb out of that pit on our own, but God had a plan of action to rescue us. Look what the Bible says there in verse 4. Talking about the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins to deliver us from the present evil age according to the will of God the Father. That is the spiritual rescue. Christianity is in fact a rescue religion. That's what it is. The Greek word there, deliver, in verse 4. Maybe some of your Bibles use the word rescue. You want to circle that word. Fabulous. It's a strong, strong verb in the Greek. It's used in Acts to refer to the rescue of the Israelites from Egyptian bondage and slavery. Acts 7:34. It's used in Acts 12:11 of the rescue of Peter from prison and from the hand of Herod. It's used in Acts chapter 23 and 27, verse 27, of the rescue of Paul from an infuriated mob who's about to lynch him, about to kill him. But this verse in Galatians, this word, deliver, rescue, it's the only place this word is used to refer to our salvation in Jesus Christ. The only place in all the Bible. Teaching us that Jesus Christ died to rescue us. What is the center of the gospel? What is the heart of the gospel? It is the death of Jesus Christ upon the cross. Notice, the death of Christ was voluntary. The death of Christ was voluntary. Look at what the Bible says there in verse 4. Who gave himself. The Bible says that Jesus willingly gave himself for our sins. Jesus himself says, I give my life. No man takes it from me. I myself lay it down. No one made Jesus go to the cross. He was willing to go to sacrifice himself for you and for me. The first thing to remember about the gospel is the voluntary death of Jesus. Not only was his death voluntary, the death of Christ was vicarious. The Bible says here, he gave himself, look at this phrase, for our sins. The word vicarious means to do something on behalf of another person, to do something in someone else's place. Now, this is important. We don't use the word vicarious a whole lot, but it's one we need to understand. We need to understand the vicarious death, the substitutionary atonement of Jesus Christ for our sins upon the cross. What it means is that Jesus Christ died in my place so that now I can have his righteousness instead of my wickedness. What it means is that Christ died on my behalf so that God punished Jesus for my sins so I don't have to pay the price. His death was vicarious. The Bible says he delivered us. He gave himself up for our sins. He went to the cross where we deserved to go. He died in the place where we deserved to die. He paid the penalty that we deserved to pay. He was our vicarious substitute. And the Bible tells us the death of Christ was victorious. It was victorious. Look at what it says. He gave himself for our sins to what? To deliver us, to rescue us, to redeem us, to forgive us, and to welcome us into his family. That word deliver suggests that Christ has conducted a successful rescue operation and set us free from the one who held us captive. The Bible says he delivers us. Look at this, Christian. You need to understand this now. Jesus saved you. Yes, you're going to heaven one day. But what does the text say? He rescued us to deliver us from this present evil age. The moment you trust Jesus, eternal life begins. Did you know that? The moment you trust Jesus, you are as saved as you'll be saved a million years from now, so that you can have His life and His power and His strength and His might here in this life and in the life to come. Salvation is not just a future hope. It's a present reality. It's not just a pie in the sky and the by and by, right? It's Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit of God in me, here and now. Other founders of religions, you know what they came to do? All the other founders of the religions, they came to teach, not to rescue. Do you know that? Every other religious teacher came to teach, not to rescue. The average person on the street believes that a Christian is someone who follows the teachings of Jesus. The average person on the street believes a Christian is somebody who follows the example of Jesus. But Paul implies that's impossible. After all, you don't rescue people unless they're lost and hopeless. You don't rescue people unless they're in a helpless condition. Imagine you see a woman and she's drowning. It does not help her at all to throw a manual to her on how to swim. She doesn't need more information. She doesn't need more teaching. What does she need? She needs to be rescued. You don't throw her teaching, you throw her a rope. And Jesus is not so much a teacher as He is a rescuer. He's not so much a teacher as He is a redeemer. Jesus reached down to rescue and redeem us and to lift us up out of the pit and to seat us in the heavenlies with Him in glory. That's what God did for us through Jesus Christ. So now, I've been rescued, I've been redeemed. This is what Christ has done for us. There's a sign on a plumber's van in South Africa. A sign on a plumber's van in South Africa. It said this: there's no place too deep, too dark, or too dirty for us to handle. Well, I'll tell you this, I don't want to be hanging out with that plumber anytime soon. But I'm so thankful that's true of Jesus. No place too deep. No place too dark. No place too dirty. No person too sinful or too far gone. No family too broken. No marriage too battered. No life too shattered. He is our rescuer. Notice the Bible tells us the spiritual rescue was initiated by God's plan. It was implemented by God's action. Listen carefully now. The spiritual rescue was instituted for God's glory. You know, if we're not careful, because Jesus loves us, because God loved the whole world, we'll begin to think this salvation thing is all about us. If we're not careful, we'll begin to elevate ourselves in our own eyes and begin to think that in some way or another we're worthy to earn God's favor or grace, or we deserve being saved. In reality, at times, if we're not careful, we begin to tell our salvation story and we're the ones who get the glory, not God. But the Bible tells us this spiritual rescue plan ought to bring glory and honor to the Lord Jesus Christ alone. The Bible says in the Old Testament, not to us, but to your name be the glory, Lord. Look what the Bible says at verse 5. Verse 5 is the end of the beginning of this entire book. Look what it says: to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. To whom? To who? Jesus and God the Father. That's who He's been talking about. Grace and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So go back to those pronouns. This is to whom it's referring in verse 5. And what does it say? This is foundational. This is fundamental. To whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Now, normally when a preacher says amen, it means he's close to getting finished. But not with the Apostle Paul. Paul is saying, I'm just getting started, but somebody's got to amen my preaching, so I'm going to go ahead and say amen because you didn't. That's what Paul's saying. To Him be glory forever and ever. Amen. It means We're not quite done yet. We're just getting started. Paul's supreme purpose was to do what? To bring honor and glory to the Lord Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory for how long? Forever and ever and ever. 1 Corinthians 10:31, do everything to the glory of God. See, here's the thing, and this is why this is so essential and important. It's why it's so necessary for us to understand the gospel clearly. Grace through faith, not of works, lest anyone should boast. This is why it's so important for us to understand. Because if we had contributed to our own rescue in one way or another, if we'd been smart enough or wise enough or strong enough to climb out of that well on our own, if we had contributed in some way, we would ensure that we always got the glory. We are the worst when it comes to being glory hogs. We're the worst. Our hearts manufacture glory for themselves all the time. That's why we love these preachers on television who talk about how we can have all the blessings and all the good stuff and never any bad. That's what we want. We're drawn to those sorts of things. And we believe them when they talk about how we can have all this money and all these riches. And God wants you to be happy. And He wants you to be wealthy as long as you give most of your money to them. That's what they want you to believe. This is why it appeals to the flesh. Because we want to believe. We want to believe that there's something good enough inside of us that God got a pretty good deal when He saved us. But the truth is, we were dead in trespasses and sins. Hopeless, helpless, headed for an eternity separated from God. The Bible says that we were in chains, shackled, in the dungeon created by our own sin. We were in the kingdom of darkness. But He translated us into His marvelous light. This is not for the glory of man. It is only for the glory of God. If Jesus is just a teacher, then we can be the star students. But if He's a rescuer and a redeemer, we did nothing to aid in our rescue. This is the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is grace plus faith equals salvation. Not grace plus goodness. Not grace plus a dress code. Not grace plus church attendance. Not grace plus church service. Not grace plus a good marriage. Not grace plus Bible reading. Not grace plus morality. Only grace through faith. That's it. And this is what we see all throughout Galatians. Paul emphasizes over and over again, Jesus Christ provides a rescue which gives our hearts the reality that there's no such thing as a false salvation. That's what we try to do. We try to rescue ourselves. But only Jesus can rescue us. You know, to find what you're looking for, you've got to go to the right place. You don't go to Burger King and order pizza, right? That doesn't make sense. If you want steak, I mean real meat, you're not going to McDonald's. If you want grace and peace and mercy and forgiveness and rescue, you've got to go to Calvary. That's where it's found, at the cross, where Christ intervened on our behalf in the greatest rescue mankind has ever seen. So that we can respond in faith and repentance and trust His marvelous work. I'm going to ask.